to the Moldbusters video training seminars. My name is Charlie, and today we're going to be looking at mold. Now, what is mold? Well, mold is a fungus, which means it's a living organism. It grows on plants, wood, fabric, soil, and food. It produces microscopic spores that germinate in the presence of water. Often found in bathrooms, basements, and attics, mold can result in major structural damage to buildings and can cause serious health problems. There are three main requirements for mold in order to grow. The first is a food source, an organic compound-based material such as wood, drywall, and fabric. The second is temperature. Now, different species grow in different temperatures ranging from about 2 to 40 degrees Celsius. And last but not least, water. Moisture is present no matter where mold is. Mold will grow within 24 to 48 hours of a water intrusion. Now, the interesting thing about mold are their mold spores. For one, is that they're microscopic, which means that they're so small that they are invisible to the naked eye. They are very light and can be dispersed through the air very easily. They're also very hard to detect and contain. Now, mold spores can also survive in severe conditions because of their thick outer wall. Now, water allows mold spores to germinate. What that means is that it takes a little bit of water for a whole bunch of mold to grow. The other dangerous thing about mold spores is that they may produce toxins, which are dangerous to health. Did you know that in just 1 square foot of drywall, there could be more than 1 billion mold spores? Now, mold is commonly found in a variety of areas, such as basements, kitchens, bathrooms, attics and crawl spaces, laundry rooms. Now, mold can also hide behind walls, under carpets, and also linger in the air that we breathe. We could also find mold in drywall, curtains, wallpaper, furniture, food, plants and soil, and a variety of other fabrics. All of that to say that mold can grow just about anywhere, providing it has the three main ingredients. Now, why is mold a problem? Two main reasons. One is it causes structural damage, which is costly and very time-consuming. The second is health effects. Mold can cause mild allergies to severe respiratory conditions. That's why mold is a problem. Now, some of the causes of mold are very widespread, but the main problem is moisture. See, if there is moisture in an area, you're likely to have mold to grow. There are two different types of moisture problems. The first is condensation, which is moisture that forms when warm, moist air comes into contact with a cold surface. You will find this on pipes. The other one is leaks, which is common in roofs and plumbing and cracks in the foundation. It's important to remember that mold can grow within 24 hours of a water intrusion. It doesn't take much time at all. Some other common sources of moisture will be from leaky pipes, roofs and faucets, cracks in walls and foundations, flooding that occurs in the springtime or during periods of heavy rain, poor ventilation and air circulation, inadequate insulation, and other sources of excess moisture. According to the CMHC, which is Canada's Mortgage and Housing Corporation, moisture is continually being released inside of our home. Actually, 10 to 50 liters per day is being released inside of our home. Now, during those hot seasons in the summertime that last typically about 200 days, when our home is typically closed up, we can accumulate up to 2,000 to 10,000 liters of moisture. For example, 1 cord of wood inside of our home can release more than 270 liters of moisture. Excess moisture plus moisture problems equals air quality problems, such as mold. There are a couple things that we could do to put mold under control. The first is minimizing moisture. That means repairing leaks, cracks, and other sources of moisture as soon as they appear. The other one is having good air circulation. So having a proper exchange of air between the indoors and outdoors is crucial. The other one is having proper ventilation to ensuring that we have proper functioning HVAC systems. And the other one is cleanliness. Regularly vacuuming and dusting our areas is a good way of ensuring that mold will not grow. Now, there's an important factor to consider when it comes to air exchange. Air exchange is the exchange of air between the indoors and outdoors. Now, air exchange is crucial to having good indoor air quality. Without it, homes can accumulate moisture, causing mold problems and having poor indoor air quality. This can result in adverse health effects and consequences for our families. Now, having proper ventilation systems in place is also important in ensuring that mold will not grow. For example, there are four main kinds of ventilation systems that we should consider. One is a passive ventilation system. The second is an exhaust-only ventilation system. The other is a balanced ventilation system. And the other is a heat recovery ventilation system. For more information on all those types of ventilation systems, be sure to visit our website at www.busmold.com. Now, there are many different types of mold. When we are testing for mold, we need to find out exactly what classification they fall under. Fortunately, molds can be classified in four primary categories, depending on their water requirements. So we have a hydrophilic type of mold, a mesophilic type of mold, a zero-tolerant type of mold, and a xerophilic type of mold. The first group is hydrophilic types of mold, which requires a lot of water. This type of mold is usually found after a significant period of water intrusion, such as bathroom leaks or a flood in a basement. Some of the most well-known species of this type of mold is Stachybotrys, otherwise known as black mold. This type of mold is extremely toxigenic. The other type of mold is a mesophilic type of mold, which requires slightly less moisture and grows in arid conditions, like little water damage. The relative humidity of this type of mold is between 30 to 50%. Some of the common species of that type of mold is cladosporium. Now, the other two groups are less common in Canada. We have zero tolerant mold, which grows in drier conditions with little humidity and moisture. Some of these species include Aspergillus and Penicillium. Now, xerophilic type of molds are very rare. They grow in very dry environments such as the desert, but they still need a little bit of moisture. All mold is allergenic. A small percentage is pathogenic and a small percentage is toxigenic. There are three ways that us as humans can be exposed to mold and suffer from those consequences. The first is inhalation. The other one is dermal contact. And the other one is ingestion. Now, did you know that simply killing mold will not prevent allergic symptoms? To stop the symptoms, it is necessary to remove all the mold, even the dead mold, from that environment. The most common forms of allergenic reactions will include mild symptoms like congestion, rash or itchy watery eyes, to moderate symptoms such as itchiness and difficulty breathing. And then we have severe allergenic symptoms such as swelling, difficulty in breathing and swallowing, abdominal cramps, vomiting, diarrhea, dizziness, and mental confusion. As you can see, these can become quite severe. There are pathogenic reactions as well, from superficial such as skin infections, nail infections, and athlete's foot, to subcutaneous, which are more serious and occurs when the infection gets under the skin, and systemic, which occurs when mold attacks the internal organs, such as the kidneys and lungs and livers. Now, this can be also very life-threatening. There are a host of toxigenic reactions that occur when in the presence of black mold. Some of them can include skin rash, nausea, fatigue, a suppressed immune system, acute chronic liver damage, acute chronic central nervous system disorders, hormone disorders, and in some cases, even cancer. As we can see, that mold can cause some serious health problems. That's why it's important to get them tested as soon as possible in order to make sure that you know and your family knows what exactly it is you're dealing with. The most common toxic forms of mold include Penicillium aspergillus groups, Stachybotrys, and Fusarium. Aspergillus is a very common indoor and outdoor type of mold. It has a very rapid growth rate. Its color and appearance will vary depending on the species. Now, Aspergillus can cause infections and allergic reactions. And actually, in some species of Aspergillus, they also produce carcinogens, which is very dangerous. Now, Penicillium is a very common indoor and outdoor type of mold as well. It's often found in basements and crawl spaces. It also has a very rapid growth rate, and it's almost identical to Aspergillus in appearance. Whenever we do reports, you will see that Aspergillus and Penicillium are often grouped together in one format. Now, they're initially white in color, but then turning blue-green over time. Penicillium produces mycotoxins. the Stachybotryl species of mold, which is commonly referred to as black mold, will grow in high cellulose contents such as drywall and lumber. Now, Stachybotrys can produce poisonous mycotoxins. This is very dangerous because the symptoms can include headaches, fatigue, coughing, diarrhea, fever, rashes, and eye irritation. Now, some forms of Stachybotrys are very carcinogenic, and this is exceptionally dangerous. You may be asking yourself, well, who is at risk for mold exposure? The truth is, everybody is. The potential, though, for adverse health effects from mold exposure are uniquely individual, since no two immune systems are alike. The people who are most at risk for mold exposure include people with compromised immune systems, infants, the elderly, and people who suffer from asthma. Health Canada states that there is a relationship between indoor mold and an increase in symptoms such as eye, nose, and throat irritation, coughing, shortness of breath, asthma, and allergic reactions. Mold growth can affect air quality because both spores and mycelial fragments that are dispersed into the air can be inhaled. The smaller the particles, the deeper they penetrate into the lungs. Now, we know that this is a lot of information to assimilate, and some of it is actually quite scary. That's why it's important to be in contact with a certified mold professional. Please visit our website at www.busmold.com to find out how you can be in contact with one of our professionals today. Thank you very much, and have a great day.